Welcome back to Black Girl Couch Reviews. I'm your host, Christina. We are back for another episode of 1899. This is number 5, I believe. Yes, entitled The Calling. This episode was directed once again by Baron Bo Odar and written by Jean-Jay Frazé and Juliana Mima Dean. I give this episode a 10 out of 10. I think it's the best out of the series thus far. It certainly came with some well-earned answers, I believe. And I feel as if I'm in the right or was going in the right direction, but I still don't have a good grasp of exactly what's going on. And by the end of it, I pretty much was like, yeah, I need to go get some Advil and take some time to rearrange my life. Got quite a bit of notes on this one. So before we jump into the recap, wherever you listen to this podcast, Podbean, Stitcher, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, go down to the rating section, drop some stars, leave a review. My social media will be there. If you want to send feedback for the next episodes that I will be dropping once or one per day this weekend. So 6 tomorrow, 7 on Sunday, and then we should be able to finish it up on Monday. BlackerCouch@gmail.com. Or you can leave a comment below.
Let's go.
Maura wakes alone in a hospital gown with the bruises that she had on her wrists in a desolated area. There's also a house in the background. She runs to a grave with a cross that says, "Wake up." This propels her back to being dragged away by the orderlies in the mental institution. She cries out, "I know what I've seen. I'm not crazy.
I'm just the crazy slut with a dead husband."
She asks about her brother, Sirion, that he found out whatever her father has been doing with these ships. And she believes that her father had something to do with his disappearance. She's dragged into the same room number as the one on the ship, so 1011. I'm thinking at this time, and I wrote down in my notes, is this all happening in the subconscious? I know Mimi said she hates dreamscapes, but I feel like these people have been taken here by some unforeseen force, and I thought, aliens? It could be an abduction. Aliens or human, one or the other. She is strapped to a chair with the biggest fucking needle ever being inserted into her neck, but it had that black goo in it. Before she is mentally back on board the Kerberos, however you say that word, the K-ship, where she hears her own voice say, "Wake up." And I need to go back and watch, because I did not have time to do so, but I will over the weekend. One, to see if I actually did see that glitch that I said I was going to check up on so I could find a timestamp. And did Maura tell everyone to wake up? That had flashbacks thus far. And I suppose we can figure out going forward as well, because I know there's got to be more people with flashbacks. Are these memories? That's also a good question that I feel like may be answered later on in the episode. She wakes to Daniel very intently watching her.
"Who the fuck are you, man?"
He tells her they locked the child up because that is the rational thing to do when you cannot explain how someone was tossed overboard and should be dead and how they reappeared in a ball of fucking light. And also, who just falls asleep on the floor like that? Even if I was exhausted, I think I would have tried to find something to pad in, at least in a different manner than just being sprawled out. She demands that the boy be let out when he starts to bang on where they put him. Now they know why his ass was locked up wherever they found him on the Prometheus. And I'm wondering, because I just had this thought that they mentioned later on, we never got this far. On the Prometheus, did these very similar events play out and the boy got locked in and he never was let out? the weapons are pointed at her, and she is like, I'm still gonna do what I'm gonna do. Like, girl, you are in a perilous situation right now, okay? A lot of people have a lot of questions, and you ain't got no answer. Ike tells her, I'm not gonna do anything until you give me something to make me not put your ass in a closet too. Also, I really dislike the intro. The way they changed White Rabbit, I haven't brought it up prior, but I do need to put this out there. They tried, but it's no Ramin Djawadi. It didn't fall through. Franz, below deck, galvanizes everyone by pointing out that they still have control of the engine room and they should simply continue on course to America, but won't see land until maybe 3 or 4 days. Finally, one of the officers points out why mutiny is usually heavily frowned upon and not really thought of, because the punishment that comes with it is death.
Oh, I knew it.
But back to Mimi's point of, yeah, nobody was thinking rationally when they were in that mob mentality to overcome why it's a bad idea. Because no one's thinking about at the end of that journey what the consequences are going to be. Because they ain't just going to be able to get the fuck up off the ship. When Franz only has the we are fucked expression to offer to that inquiry, bitch Zilla, also known as Ibn, reminds them that justice will prevail for those following the light. Says every martyr before the flames. She tells them they will not surrender even if more sacrifices need to be made, and I want her to choke on those words. Toby walks away in disgust, ignoring her mother's pleading eyes.
Stop it. Get some help.
She goes to find her brother Crestor, who's still just in a perpetual state of on the cusp of tears. Broken and torn between religion and his mother's love versus his own sexuality. And there's the loss of his sister. I think that the contentious relationship with their mothers is something that both Fabio, aka Angel, and Crestor have in common. They both remember their sister as the special one, unafraid of their mother, going on her own journey. Apparently, the plan was for Crestor, Toby, and Ada to go to America and leave her mother behind and father by default. Mother has been hearing voices for quite a while now. She thinks they're the voices of God or angels, but it is just madness, and they've been living in her delusional fantasy as sheep for far too long. When she points out that his fanaticism led to the murder of a child, he points out that she has murdered also. She says that was different, looking very affronted, realizing her brother, the only person she was staying around for, is a lost cause, now drowning. Under his own well of guilt, she grabs a loaded weapon and switches the side of the same.
Well, I've done all I can do.
An electronic type of signal is turned on. Lucien, who, by the way,
sploosh,
tells Clement, is it Clement or Clements? I always want to say the French version, that he did love her despite his life being a lie. She's like, you're not a lieutenant. You didn't win any medals of honor. You don't have no land. And thinks that she had it easy. But you still the one that lied. And how you gonna tell me I had it easy? You don't know my life story. With that baby pistol. That gun is for a toddler. Mara isn't the only woman involved in a love triangle, it would seem. And I'm like, oh no, triangles. There's like three already. We got Angel, Romero, and Crestor ends in tragedy. Mara, Ike, and Daniel also feels to be tragic. Lucien, Jerome, and Clement, tragic because Lucien is dying. And the other two used to be friends. This is just triangles all over the place. I see the metaphor. And I am going to now be on the lookout to see what other ones fall into that scope. But we already got way too damn many. Oleg, because he friends with the baddest motherfucker in the room, demands to know what's next, Captain, who is having whispering conversations with suspect Mora. And Daniel, who lurks so closely, I'm starting to wonder if anyone sees him until there was a clear acknowledgement of his presence. So I'm like, when did he get invited to this conversation that they was having? He legit freaks me out. But also,
sploosh.
Toby shows up with her own weapon, saying she knows how to stop her mother, and is immediately drawn into what's in the box. What's over there? Why is there something banging? What's going on? Mara ignores all the guns and goes for it, but when someone fires, Daniel leaps to take the bullet and the entire room and everyone in it freezes.
What? What the fuck?
Of course, my brain was going construct, construct, construct. It's gotta be construct. Hopefully, maybe, I don't know. She removes the bullet, so now Daniel gonna feel real foolish falling in front of nothing. I like the fact that her hand was shaking. Like, this should not be happening. This doesn't make any sense. However, I'm going to see if this is actually something I can do. And then she removes the bullet. It reminds me of Umbrella Academy. That's why my mind's starting to go into too many directions. And I'm just going to let Mimi do all that. Mimi and Shy. I have modest ideas. She releases the little boy who still doesn't have a name, and I'm not sure why his face is always a poutish type of sulky expression. But a little bit later, when he actually got lines, he looked like a regular boy. So I'm thinking they told him to look like that on purpose. Like, look like you're like a distressful devil. He won't answer her questions, but does take her away from the room where time is restarted and everyone is going nuts.
Explain to me. Explain to me!
And yes, I am a juvenile. Because I did cackle very loudly when Daniel fell. Both Ike and Daniel wonder where their wife went, getting all tense about it, with Daniel looking a little freaked out as a siren goes off. That boy is not that strong that you can't get him to stop when you tell him to stop, as all the doors seem to unlock in the corridor simultaneously, like the tea sipping, and people pour into the corridors. Angel wants to know what's going on. Bullets going off, it's been time passing, and his ass been stuck in his room. Like Crestor, I think they're both cowards in a sense. Toby, pregnant, gets between two men to remind Ike he is the captain and has them to be concerned about, not this redheaded woman you just met yesterday. He tells them in English, look, I ain't got no explanation for all the supernatural type of shit going on. All I can tell you is our biggest problem, besides whatever the fuck, is the coal. Because no one is rationing it, and we've been going full speed since I've been demoted. And if we do not ration, they will be dead in the ocean before reaching land. And I don't think you're ever meant to reach land, homie. I think you're just meant to run out of coal and be left dead in the ocean. So Daniel agrees they need to take control of the engine room and settle this mutiny once and for all. Then the ticking begins.
It's the final countdown.
The Grim Reaper has come aboard as many in a trance start marching to the beat of their own death. And the sound attracts Yin Lee's mama, who joins them with her daughter coming out the bathroom like, where'd you go? What is the significance of those that are chosen and those that are not? Is it like Westworld and the ones that are aware are not susceptible? Or is this just a natural ending to the experiment that should have went one way and is now seemingly going another? Or are these people chosen because inwardly they're all ready to die? Kressler certainly felt as if he were at the end of his rope. As he too joins in the march, Eben demands to know what is going on as Ankur sees his son under the trance and sadly in the engine room, so is our poor Landon.
No, God! No, God, please, no! 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 No!
He left his garlic behind and his friend picked it up. Bitchzilla said the devil is calling them. You know she might not be wrong because the devil is usually a man without a conscience. All the people fall to their deaths, going overboard on the rails, only a few dramatically. One felt like he did a twist spin, like he was doing an Olympic dive. But they all plunged themselves into the ocean. Poor Ankur and Ying Li had to watch their loved ones perish. Clement and Lucien realize what is happening, and she grabs his hand tightly because when you have no one and Jerome ain't around, he'll do. Mora pulls the boy into a room and demands once again for him to talk to her. So he writes down they are listening before whispering in her ear, I can't tell you, you have to ask the creator. You couldn't have just whispered all of that? Sebastian puts in a code, not at all dismayed at the massive death march. The two sides come at a crossroads in the corridors, but Ankur comes back to inform everyone that the people are jumping and that Kressler is now dead to the horror of his mother, who for once seems shook up, and so is poor Toby. I felt more bad for Toby. Ankur feels as if he's just under the cult of personality, but you got children you got to look out for. You can't have her doing that to them kids. The boy leads Mora into the hatch where the beetle creates a doorway back to the desolate landscape that she was at the top of the episode, where someone half died since there is a cross or a grave there, no name. And the building in the background is the mental institution where she was kept. But this also was a place where she was a doctor at. Daniel sneaks away and runs to Mara's room once suspicion is finally off of him from Ike. And genuinely is freaked out at both having gone down the hatch. There was a lot of fucks in this episode. He uses his device to create a door to the same location. He tells the boy who is standing over the grave, and my question immediately is that his grave. He says, you shouldn't have done that. It knows we're here now. And I'm like, it? Is that the simulation? We never made it this far. The boy replies, maybe it will work this time, indicating they've been in a cycle. The boy tells Daniel, Mara doesn't remember when he asks why he brought her here. He assures the boy he is Henry Singleton, won't find him and that he must stay here as they are running out of time before they sink the ship and he must stop the signal. It feels very much like this is a paternal relationship. I think that Mora, Daniel, and this kid were a family at some point. She doesn't remember them, but they both seem to be interested in getting her to retrieve those memories. Ramiro starts running to find Angel because now the people that are still not susceptible are thinking this is a contagion and they need to strap themselves down so that they don't fall prey to it. So Ramiro finds Angel to tie him up. Or to keep him from actually leaving his room. He has mentally deteriorated. Or did he actually go into some type of trance? Because I feel as if the same with Ibn. Something took over. Jerome busts into Lucien's and disarms him, forcing both to tie themselves up. Clement and Lucien. She didn't even question. She's like, yes, daddy.
Everything I do.
Lucy ends all, kill me now. It doesn't matter anyway. It's like, bitch, I came here to give you the biggest fuck you of your life. I'm here because I'm trying to fucking save y'all, but not really y'all, just her. And he ties himself up. Minnie follows suit with Ibn now catatonic after the news that Crestor jumped. Do I feel bad?
Nope.
Don't treat your children like shit. Don't talk about people making sacrifices if you're not willing to make the ultimate sacrifice, or that being your child. And also, don't fuck up your kids. The only man still trying to do his job gets another message that says sink ship. Daniel goes back to being Kerber's version of Batman in the engine room. I don't know why it cracked me up the way in which he jumped over that rail, but it did. He's trying to stop the ticking. Landon's buddy, who's the only person still working in the engine room, or most likely just standing around, didn't think that he could even go upstairs, comes to investigate, and the two get into a tussle. He really could have just hung on to his justifiable life for much longer than he allowed himself to, because he just got real nosy. Like, where'd you say he was from again? What's that all about? Like, dude, shut the fuck up and let me do my job. The keypad apparently can deactivate participants as well, because when he starts beating them with a shovel and choking them out, he just pushes a button and poor Landon's friend is just out cold. But what is interesting is Daniel saying that if I don't stop it, it will start all over again. And that's when I said, that's got to be simulation confirmed. So Mara at the Menstol. Mara at the Mental Institute is in memories, right? So now who are they that are watching? And I think that has something to do with her father. Is the simulation in control? These are the questions I had at this moment. And who is in the unmarked grave? She goes into the same room, 1011, and confronts her father about Sirion and demands again to know where her brother is. We've seen this conversation. Repetitively, she's injected with the black goo, clearly didn't get what she needed after being told she is asking the wrong questions, and is now back on the Caribous.
We lost that round, but it's not over yet. You get ready for the next one.
At least she finally realized she needs an ally and runs to find Ike, who wants answers. I love how you just be manhandling her. She probably was going for a hug. The boy can stop time, she tells him, because she gives all of the tea. With the pyramid that he has, her father, Henry Singleton, when he takes her to his cabin, bought the ships and may be conducting experiments because he's always been obsessed all her life with human behavior and how the mind works. And I was thinking, isn't that the field that Mara studied? The human mind? As well as in the memory, he did ask, what did you do with it? Indicating she may have stolen something from her father. Could that be the pyramid itself? Is that some type of control? All good questions. Franklin is her mother's maiden name, and the ships are away, rigged to study the people on board, is what she has surmised. The letters they all got, she believes, are from her brother, Sirion, as Henry is short for Henriette, which is not only her middle name, but her brother's nickname for her, which is also her father's name.
Interesting.
Before I could even throw some suppositions in there, she admits her father favored her over her brother, and thus why he called her another version of their father, because he believed that she was turning into her father, thinking she's obsessive too over human behavior. Would that make her even more crazy if she lost someone? Her brother contacted her 4 months ago, wanting them to meet at the same dock that the Prometheus left, which means her brother used her name as an alias, or worse, she was on that fucking ship and doesn't remember it. Something she also tells Ike, because either her brother was using her name as an alias, or she was on that fucking ship because she's having some gaps in her memory. And the bug shows up just in time because she was saying her brother was gone for as long as she lost something else, but stops at that point. She captures the bug, then says, let me go ahead and open Ike's tunnel to a portal into the woods where his home is located, because there's nothing like seeing to believe. Having been converted as a member of the Gospel of Mara, both wonder how one can fit something like a ship or, I don't know, a whole ass house or mental institution into a ship unless you are way further in the future than you think, or you are inside of your mind or in some type of construct, your consciousness is anyway. They go on a mission to see how many others I thought have these shafts, but no, instead they just go to the deck. Sebastian is the one on a mission, as every passenger must be dead by now because people were going overboard for a long time. I love how people were having casual conversations too. And she just kept seeing people go whoosh, whoosh, splish, splash, taking a bath. She actually doesn't think they're dead either, something she brought up. But, poor guy. He's like, they want us to sink the ship. I don't understand. We got this message. You don't need to understand. As Sebastian takes out one of those controllers that Daniel has and seemingly deactivates him. Sebastian, by the way, is faux Jared Harris. I finally found his actual name. Mara doesn't think the people going overboard are dying. I think I already mentioned that. And she believes she figured things out before, but her father is making her forget. She knows she was a doctor at the mental institution, but he is manipulating her into thinking she was the patient, or you were the doctor, and then he became the patient when you went insane. Though she actually doesn't recall who she is, or even if she was on the Prometheus, and my brain hurted at that moment. And hurted is not a word, but that's the feeling in which I had. That's not all. Ike's like, I gotta tell you more. My signature actually is on this passenger manifest page as well. So I must have been the captain on that ship. Two, meaning that they are both on a loop, just on different ships. Unsettling synth music indeed. Daniel finally stops the ticking, and Angel, coming back to his senses, is happy that Romero came back. He's like, of course I did. You didn't think they would look for Romero, though. That's not a good sign of a healthy relationship and a shipcrester and Angel Moore. Sorry, not sorry. Speaking of, Ibn once again recalls that her son is dead and the family comfort her. Do I still feel bad?
Nope.
Jerome, after untying himself, realizing that the sound has stopped, acts like Lucien doesn't exist when he asks Jerome what is going on, just takes his gun, eye fucks his wife, and leaves. Everyone convenes on deck with Virginia, saved in the nick of time from going overboard, saying, I have had the strangest dream. Latecomer Sebastian gives Ike the message he got from the company about sinking the ship once again. And Daniel, also the second person on board that is knowing more than they are saying, confirms that the company must be trying to sink them. So now we can get everyone aligned on the same goal. And he did the same thing prior when they were talking about what should we do. He got everyone into taking back the ship. Somewhere, Henry Singleton gets a message from Project Corobus. And he replies that he doesn't have much time when he reads it. Who is he? My guess is Sebastian. And that he needs to bring him the boy. And now we know who the boy is afraid of. Outside in a frosty landscape, as we saw a flash of in the first seconds of the series is that damn pyramid, and he even has it on his lapels. Great music choice, but also...
I ask you, what in the fuck are we doing here?
So I have already given what my musings are at the moment of what I think is going on, and that is the perfect segue over to the feedback. So take it away as we head into the mailbag.
Hey Christina, it's me, Shy. I am here to give my feedback for 1899, episode 5. I wish I had watched this episode during the weekend, but it was just one of those weird weekends. I didn't watch hardly any television or any TV shows. So I am trying to play my version of catch up, which is... good luck with that. The good thing is it's holiday week, which means a lot of people are out on vacations or visiting whoever. So it usually be usually a slower time of the year for us. So that's good. As for this episode, look, you know, I know when I can admit when I'm way over my head and when I got nothing and when I'm just clueless, puzzled, I don't get it, whatever the case may be. And so that's where I'm at with this. I've decided to just take it all in and because watch the episode and see where it leads because... trying to figure out what's going on and why is this and why is that happening. It's just too much of a hassle. It's too straining on the brain. And I'm, you know, and it's Monday. I usually don't try to give feedback on Mondays or Fridays because either Mondays are a long day and my brain is just not up for the task, or Friday is a long week. And same thing, my brain is not up to the task. And I can tell, I don't think a Saturday would have made much of a difference in this one. So the boy finally spoke and he still gave a whole bunch of nothing. He started talking about the creator, you gotta ask the creator, talk to the creator. And I'm assuming the creator is her father. And I'll just start out with that end scene. I know I forgot to mention it before when we saw the TV screens, but that this is definitely, he is in another time because I saw a telephone, we saw a lamp. I could have sworn we saw some machines in there. So, and Maura did say that her father was doing some type of experiment. So, are they like inside this pyramid with him experimenting on them? Like he's gotten some subjects and I'm not trying to go down a rabbit hole, but I also I'm doing my best to try to figure out what's going on. So he's definitely in the future. And so maybe this whole thing is in the future, but they're doing some type of experiment. Like scenarios from the past, kind of thing. Like maybe there's something significant about 1899 and I'm too lazy to look it up to see if there's some historical significance about that specific year, in Europe or something like that. But, she talked about her dad. We saw the mental institution, she found out something. And so her father try to silence her by erasing her memory, or making her think like she's crazy or whatever the case may be. She says she's more a singleton and not Franklin. And so I'm like, so was like her great grandmother on this boat, on this ship, and something happened. But then we got the
the flash scene where they shot the rifle and time stopped. And she was able to pick it out of the air and everyone was frozen. And so I'm like, I can't even begin to know what that's about. I mean, like, you know, and they locked the little boy. And so, and then it's like, just like the Prometheus, that's why he was locked in that thing. But whereas before, we're wondering, well, why, where is everybody else? How did he get locked in there? Well, they locked him in there. And then everybody must have jumped off the ship. So, like, and that's why he was there by himself, because he was the only one left, from what I can gather. So that's what happened with the Prometheus. And then he's trying again with, whatever the name of the ship is. I don't know. And now we're finding out that the captain was also the captain of the Prometheus. So they're like redoing something. And I think the boy was telling the guy that, you know, maybe it'll be different this time. So it's like they're like redoing the experiment with the same people. But I don't know, because Moore was talking about how they're not really dead, even though they jumped overboard. So it's like, what? So, I mean, is it a simulation? They're not really dead. I mean, the boy didn't die. He was thrown overboard and he ends up and he like magically appears in the cabinet. I didn't listen to the episode four feedback yet. So if y'all have some theories, I'm excited to hear about that situation, which y'all thought about that. I'm like, it's almost like it's a, like Lamora said, like he's trying to figure something out or get to the bottom of something. So he keeps redoing. But I don't know why he needs to rename the ship. The Prometheus wasn't, they didn't say sink the Prometheus, but they said sink this ship. But then I'm like, why would you? Yeah, I'm not connecting the dots on that. And then we got the first mate who has the same gadget as the guy. So I'm like, so are they getting messages? Are they, because we see that when he did the moving parts, the guy, then the Prometheus disappeared. And then he's able to like, so are they outliers in this whole thing? Like they're to control, make sure things, I don't know, but the man seems to be very protective of Mora and wanting her to complete something finish something in order to set things right. I don't know. I mean, I thought first I was like, is that her brother? But then like, we remember her brother. And I'm like, is that someone, I think I said in my last feedback, a significant other? Because he's really, like, again, protective of her and making sure that she's okay. And him and the boy seem to be upset that she doesn't remember. So that's why I'm more not leaning towards her brother, because I would think she would remember her brother even if they erased her memory. Because she's remembering her brother, like she's talking about her brother. So you would think she would remember what he looks like. So is it someone that she was dating, was involved with, you know? I don't know. And then they go through these corners and, I mean, these tunnels. And then they, like, each cabinet leads to their past or a significant event in their past. And that's supposed to mean something. I don't know. At this point, like I said, I just want to just watch the episodes and, you know, let whatever happens happen, because I don't have any credible theories on what could be going on. These people just jumping overboard, you know, Crester, he just left. I thought the dad would surely stop him, but nope, they can't even, like, how can you not stop them? Like, some of them, I'm not saying they would have stopped all of them, but like, really, none of them? You couldn't keep none of them from, like, throw them in a room and lock the door. I just find that really weird that nobody can stop anybody. It was like, or they got superpower or super strength once they are in this haze or daze or whatever kind of comatose state, whatever you want to call it. So that's all I got. I mean, I didn't contribute much to this. So, yeah, but it's my thoughts is what I got for this one. So look forward to episode 6 and getting some more answers. You know, we see the pyramid and we got the little pyramid and the boy and everyone's looking for the boy. His boy means something. So I would have thought that was her child, but then I'm like, maybe it's a guy as a young child. I don't know. Anyway, on that note, till next time, much love, peace, and black on magic. Queen of the couch, Shy.
Thank you, Shy, for your thoughts on the episode. Don't have much to add because I think I am, like, y'all was the one jumping on that. I want to go down to the rabbit hole and I want to be down here. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Now you're coming back up to my side of things where I'm like, yep, mm-hmm. I'm watching this as I go along. I'm not going to stretch my brain too hard. I already stretched enough this damn episode. But two things. They did try to stop people, but I don't know if you've ever been in a situation where someone's absolutely dead weight and you can't, like, they have no control over their body. It's amazing the strength of a human person. I mean, it's never really brought into context until you have a situation, because I think they did. It was about, I mean, think of all the ones that were sane and that were surviving versus the ones that they would have had to stop. Yeah, I think they could have put a couple of people in some rooms, but it feels like at the end that everyone was kind of every man for himself. Like, they were like, we got to tie ourselves up or we could fall in susceptible to the same thing. So I think there was an effort made. But when you have 6 people against 1,300 and they're all piling to the same place, you ain't going to stop too many people. But yeah, I agree. There could have been a couple of people, but something was forcing them. Cause even if you locked them in the room, clearly they were getting out. So I think whatever had a hold of them was far more powerful than anyone was going to be able to do to stop it, especially when it's that amount of people. I think they said there was something like 1,300, 1,100. I know it was over 1,000 passengers versus the 13, 15, maybe 20 at best people still alive. And not under the control. And lastly, what did I mean by this? Well, if you don't want your controls to know, why change the ship names? If you don't want your controls to know what you're doing, you try to keep everything relatively the same, or they might notice a pattern in the simulation that's different. So I don't know. That's if I'm sticking to my simulation theory of why it would be different ships. It could be different people, but it doesn't seem to be the case, but it could be. I don't know. I think those are all question marks. Oh, additionally, since you haven't listened to the last podcast, I think, cause I'm watching for who gets credit and who doesn't get credit. All right. So I don't want to hear if she ends up being, he ends up being like a lover or a dog. Like, you've thrown every scenario it could possibly be. So taking credit for any of those, I'm just letting you know. It's not your credit, because throwing everything at the wall, seeing who sticks. And being like, I knew that was the son. I knew that was the son. Or I knew that was the husband or something. Yes, we all are picking up on there's a familial type of connection there in some type of manner. Yes, I think we're all spot on that part. What that connection is exactly, we don't know. But I just had to put that out there, that caveat, because it'd be funny. I know you and Mimi so well. You'd be like, so I know I called it. But yeah, I am looking forward to the 4-day weekend. That's for damn sure. And I only work 3 days next week. And then I'm on vacation. Woo! And then I'm probably going to be going to another job. Not probably. I am going to be going to another job sometime after the new year. I just don't know if it's going to be that Monday or the Monday after. So we shall see. I think that's everything I wanted to mention in regards to your feedback. So let's hear what Queen Mimi has to say.
What up, Stina? It's Mimi. This is feedback for 1899 episode 5 of season 1. I don't see that you posted it, so I'm just going to try and get this out as quick as possible. I haven't been feeling well, and I've worked a lot in the last, I would say I was working Thursday through Sunday, and then Friday night I haven't felt good, and I've just been sleeping on my last couple of days off. I work tonight, and then I'll work tomorrow, and then I'll be off for about 10 days, so that'll be nice. I get a little recuperation before I start this new job. So hopefully I'm not coming down with anything. I've gone to the doctor and I've tested negative for everything, but I still don't feel well. So I don't know. I always say, you know your body and you know when something isn't right. And I don't know if I'm just tired because my job was kicking my butt, or if I had something and then my body got rid of it and I'm just not testing positive to it anymore. And I'm just in that fatigue stage. I'm not sure. Doesn't matter, but I just couldn't get up enough energy to send this during, like, I was gonna send it on my when I was driving to work, but then it was snowing, so I couldn't do it then. And then the in between my work shifts, I was just running late because I slept so long in between my shifts. So I'm just gonna go with what I remember. I watched this last week. It's literally been a week, so I don't remember everything. I don't remember all the theories I had that I was going to go into, but I remember that they heard some type of sound, and a lot of people were just like they were in like some type of hypnosis state, and they started walking off of the ship. I will say though, I do remember watching the geisha see her mom walk to the edge, and I don't feel like, like even with Crestor, I don't feel like they try hard enough. Now, I'm not saying I would know exactly what to do if I saw my child walking to the edge of the boat, but I know that I would be running towards them, and if I wanted them to not stop screaming their name would be like the first step, and then if that did not work, my next step would be to tackle them to the ground. Like, you're not about to jump off this ship. What the fuck is wrong with you? If I gotta like knock your ass out, drag you to the ground, or lay my heavy body on top of you until you don't move, that's what I'm gonna do. Like, I don't know. I don't remember. I think maybe Crestor's father just didn't get there in time. But I know the geisha, she saw her mom. She was screaming her name. Her mom didn't acknowledge her. And then she like looked at her before she jumped off. And I just felt like that was a chance. Like, she had a chance to try and like run to her. But she did, maybe she was just in a like a frozen state. She was shocked. I don't know. But I know that, you know, it can't be a coincidence that the tone like connected to people in a certain way. It seemed like there was like a lot of time, like from when it first happened, there was like a wave, and then there was the next group of people, and then they eventually like started to tie people down. And like Jerome went in there with Lucien and his wife and like handcuffed him to the bed. It was like, you know, I'm doing this to protect you. Well, I feel like he was talking. Jerome was not talking to Lucien. He was talking to his wife. I still feel like there has to be some type of connection between them. I guess we'll never know about Crestor and Angel, since Crestor decided he was going to jump off of the boat. But they just, that instant connection to me just can't be a coincidence. Even look at the geisha and Olak, same thing. Like, I don't remember where he was going, but he was in like an uproar, maybe he was trying to save people from jumping off the ship. And then he saw her, and like just nothing else mattered. It was like tunnel vision. He only saw her, and comforting her seemed to be his main concern. I need to stop her from jumping off, or I need to stop her from being sad. Like, that was the same kind of connection that Jerome had with Lucien's wife. I just can't imagine that this is a coincidence. I really feel like this is all, they're all tied up. I don't know how. And like I said, I watched it so long ago, I don't remember what I was thinking. But I know that, like, I keep seeing the connection, and it keeps ringing true to me. The other thing is, we finally heard the little strange boy talk. And he said to what's his name, Daniel, the neighbor, you know, he said she didn't remember. And I don't know, it seemed like I'm really grasping at that that's her son. And I don't know if it's her son in another altered reality or if her son in the future, I don't know. But one thing I could say that I just, the entire episode, I could not see. Now, maybe Shy has more solid evidence and she can back me up on this, but I didn't have time to look stuff up like I wanted to. But one of the things I remember, like, I know at the, I think it's the, how do you say the ship name? The Corvus? The ship that they're on? The main character, the girl, I'm blanking on her name and I don't even care to think too hard about it. The redhead. She, Mora, she has a room number that says 1011. But when we saw her, like, having those, like, she was in that, like it looked like she was in a memory, that room number was the same. The one thing I remember, and I cannot not unsee, is when she walked to the door said mental health. That is a phrase that is relatively new. That's not what they used to call psychiatric facilities. I don't remember when it was changed. I know that when I was in college the first time with my bachelor's degree in psychology, I graduated in 2006. But like mental health was a fairly new term, and I remember learning that from my professor of psychiatry, introduction to psychiatry. They used to have other names, but they decided that they had negative connotations. So they were really like going strong and trying to get everyone to realize that we shouldn't call it this. We shouldn't call it that. We should call it mental health. I don't remember what the other term was. Like, behavioral health is something that's new. Like, these terms are not something that they used to say back in 1899. Like I said, Shy, back me up. Maybe I'm misremembering, because that was a long time ago, 2006, but I'm fairly positive that that's a relatively new term, and it's not something they used to say back in 1899. That's the one thing that sticks out to me, and that's the one thing that I do want to point out. I don't know what it means, and like I said, I am too exhausted and mentally drain to even try and think too hard. This is one of those shows where, you know, you need all your your brain powers to get through. That's why I haven't even went to the next episode. But since I saw that you had not posted this episode, I just wanted to get that out. I also was thinking about the wormhole that he opened with the pyramid. Like, that's like, it just showed up. Like, that's the, I don't know. This ship has to be something. Like, I'm even leaning towards, like, alien technology. But when we went to Mora's dad, like, in the facility he's at the end, there was a pyramid outside. It didn't look like any kind of place I've ever seen. It didn't look like Egypt, but, I mean, it looked like it was cold, but there was a pyramid there. So I don't know. All this stuff is just swimming around in my head. And since I wanted to get this out, like I said, I just wanted to just shoot around the stuff that I was thinking about. Don't remember everything in the episode, but, you know, them getting rid of everyone in the ship, I felt like that was something that's probably happened on the Prometheus. And I still stick to maybe the Prometheus and the Krabaris are joined together, because this is... you know, this is a time loop. And the little boy did say, you know, we've never made it this far before. So there's just things that are clicking here that are making me think that maybe, you know, my idea about it being, you know, some type of time loop, or, you know, something like that, it might have some ring of truth to it. So I think that's all I'm going to say from now. So I'll end it here. Until next time, love, peace, hair grease, and Black Girl Magic. Queen of the Couch, Mimi out.
Thank you, Queen Mimi, with your thoughts on the episode. Yeah, I was kind of not feeling the best myself, and then my daughter wasn't feeling the best, so kind of put off this podcast till Friday until today. So glad you were able to get it in. I hope you're feeling better. Yes, for person IA, I love how I write notes to your comments, and I don't even know what the fuck I wrote. So we'll come back to that. Yes, the instant connections. I do believe there's something about the past and the present here. Your time loop theory still is high up there in what is actually going on, because that still fits. It is the same room number as her number on the ship. I don't think I can do any math to try to see if that's an anagram. I think the Shy was saying, I don't want to look into 1899. I don't either. I really don't. I just, you know, I've already made that clear. I have no time to do. If I glance upon it, I shall. Maybe tonight when I'm really bored. I can't find myself being bored, though. I got a lot of stuff on deck that I'm still trying to do, which is read and get an exercise section in there. They were called asylums, not mental institutions. You are correct on that one, but don't ask me which year, or I will defer to you on that one. But yeah, this could be, and I think you're correct on that one as well, sometime in the future. It has to be, because the technology, I think we all came to that conclusion, pretty much fits. Oh, I was saying for one person. That's what I was saying. Yes, for one person, if you wanted to try to tackle them and save them like you were saying, I think that could be a little bit more effective. And that's what everyone decided to do, was to focus on their loved ones. And but everyone, going back to what Shai said, why didn't they stop everyone? I think that's, it's like, yeah, we can't save you all, so we're going to focus on the people we can. And yeah, I will say she was probably in shock. Like, what's going on? Why is everyone going here? You're not crazy enough to jump off the ship, though, are you? But then when you see them other two people going, I would have been like, okay, mama, no. But some people, they do. They freeze when it comes time to take any formidable action. I don't know how I would react, but I would like to think that I would surely be doing the same thing, being more proactive and trying to stop the tragedy. And yes, Ankur's father certainly got there too late, because he even went up about three or a couple of minutes, or maybe not that long, but a minute or so before his son, he noticed the son going up. And that's all I have to comment on your feedback. I think everyone is pretty much on the same page, but I think you're still the only one trying to really theorize before, or figure out the puzzle before it gets to the end. I'm more like just trying to figure it out in the context of the episode. I think that's where Shai has retracted herself back from. So I don't know if you're going to get a cosign on this one, but we shall see. If you want to include yourself into the conversation, blackercouch@gmail.com, or you can leave a comment below. My social media will be there as well. Like, share, subscribe. Until the next time, peace, hair grease, Black Girl Magic.